Number four, the fourth ingredient is al-istighfar. The fourth ingredient is al-istighfar. Yani, seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is from the most potent ways and means of repelling the trials and the afflictions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yaqul fi surah al-anfal, verse number 33, he said, subhana wa ma kana Allah liyu'adhibahum wa anta fihim, yani ya Rasulullah, wa ma kana Allah mu'adhibahum wa hum yastaghfirun. Where he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah would not punish them. Allah would not punish them while you, Muhammad, are amongst them. Nor will he punish them while they seek Allah's forgiveness. And that's in Surah Al-Anfal, verse number 33. So they sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the people of the mustaghfirin, those who seek forgiveness from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah will not punish them. They will be saved from the trials and the tribulations. They will pass, they will be successful. And Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions, he said, أَمَّا الْعَذَابَ الْمَدْفُورِ, as for the punishment that is repelled, فَهُوَ يَعُمُّ الْعَذَابَ السَّمَاوِي وَيَعُمُّ مَا يَكُونُ مِنَ الْعَبْدِ عِبَادِ وَذَلِكَ أَنَّ الْجَمِيعَ قَدْ سَمَّاهُ اللَّهُ عَذَابًا. As we studied yesterday, Ibn Taymiyyah, he says, rahimahullah ta'ala, that this punishment that has been repelled, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this punishment that has been repelled incorporates that which is from Allah, from His justice subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved them from that, from His mercy. And that which comes from the oppression, from the creation and the servants of Allah, and all of this is called adab. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save the mustaghfirin, those who are indeed seeking forgiveness, they seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah save them. Barakallahu feekum. And Imam al-Sa'di rahimahullahu ta'ala, qala al-Shaykh al-Sa'di rahimahullah, wa ma kana Allah mu'adhibahum wa hum yastaghfirun, regarding the statement, and Allah would not punish them whilst they are seeking forgiveness. He said, فَهَذَا مَانِعٌ مِنْ وُقُوعِ الْعَذَابِ بِهِمْ بِمَا أُنْعَقَدَتْ أَسْبَابَهُ وَأُنْعِقَدَتْ أَسْبَابَهُ. And that is that he said, rahimullah, that them seeking forgiveness is a shield and a repellent from the punishment befalling them, from that which they took from the means, in trusting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in being sincere, in obeying Allah, and seeking forgiveness from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now we look after this at examples of some of the prophets who are the best of the mustaghfirin. The prophets and the rusul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were from the best of those who sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from them was Adam, Abuna alayhi salatu wa salam, where he said, qala رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُنَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. In Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 23, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that they said, yani Adam and his wife, alayhi salatu wa salam, O our Lord, we oppressed ourselves, we wronged ourselves. And if you do not forgive us and have mercy upon us, we will be from the losers. We will definitely be from the losers. We will surely be among the losers. So therefore in this verse we understand that the fact that they know that the one who receives the ghufran, the forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're the ones who will not be from the khasirin. They're the ones who will not be from the losers, which means they'll be successful in the trials. They'll be successful in the trials of this dunya and the hereafter. And Ibn Taymiyyah rahimullah ta'ala, he says, rahimullah, وَقَدْ ذَكَرَ عَنْ آدَمَ أَبِي الْبَشَرِ أَنَّهُ اسْتَغْفَرَ رَبَّهُ وَتَابَ إِلَيْهِ فَاجْتَبَاهُ رَبَّهُ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ وَهَدَاهُ. And it's been mentioned regarding Adam, the father of man, that he sought forgiveness from his Lord and repented to him. And Allah chose him. Allah chose him and forgave him and guided him. But as for Iblis, the father of the jinn, لعنه الله أصر متعلقا بالقدر, he was stubborn, trying to use decree, meaning the way he was created, and his decree and the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, trying to use that to justify his disobedience. فلعنه, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed him. فمن أذنب وتاب وندم فقد أشبه أباه وَمَنْ أَشْبَهَ أَبَاهُ فَمَا ظَلَمْ. So therefore, the one who sins and then repents to Allah and regrets falling into that sin, then has indeed followed the footsteps and imitated his father, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. وَمَنْ أَشْبَهَ أَبَاهُ فَمَا ظَلَمْ. And the one who follows the footsteps of his father, he has not done wrong. So we follow the footsteps of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam in seeking forgiveness and seek refuge in Allah from the footsteps of a shaitan in his stubbornness and disobedience to our Rahman. Another example is the example of Hud, Prophet Hud alayhi salatu wasalam, Nabiullah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Hud, verse number 52, وَيَا قَوْمِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدَرَارًا وَيَزِدُكُمْ قُوَّةً إِلَى قُوَّتِكُمْ وَلَا تَتَوَلَّوْا مُجْرِمِينَ. And this is the da'wah and the call of Hud. He called Ad to the obedience and worshipping Allah alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala, without any partners. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and he said to his people, and O my people, seek forgiveness from your Lord and then repent to him. And as a reward, he will send you from the sky abundant rain, fertilizing the ground, as the ulama have mentioned. In Surah Hud, this is. He will send you abundant rain and add strength to your strength, increase you in strength, because Ad were known to be a strong people. They were known to be a tribe that was strong. And if you sought forgiveness from your Lord and repented to him, he will add strength to your strength, increase you in quwwah. وَيَزِيدُكُمْ قُوَّةً إِلَىٰ قُوَّتِكُمْ. Increase you in strength. So do not turn away as criminals, disbelievers in Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So this is in the da'wah of Hud, showing his people that in seeking forgiveness from Allah, you increase in strength. So likewise, ibadallah, seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from your sins. We need to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from our sins and shortcomings. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will increase the person in strength and quwwah. So when it comes to the times of trials and tribulations and afflictions, the person is qawi. The person is strong and well equipped. Because he turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sincerely seeking forgiveness from him, from his hafawat and his shortcomings. Another example for us to reflect on, and we've touched on this in the last lesson, and that is the affair of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. The affair of Musa. As we can remember, when we were talking about the definitions and the different meanings of fitna in the Quran, and I'm sure if I were to ask you, you would remember, inshallah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned fitna in the Quran as the meaning of al-iqtibar, al-imtihan, as a trial, as a test. As he said, وَقَتَلْتَ نَفْسًا فَنَجَّيْنَاكَ مِنَ الْغَمِّ وَفَتَنَّاكَ فُتُونًا. In Surah Taha, verse number 40 that we studied yesterday, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said regarding Musa, and you had killed someone, then we delivered you from your grief and distress, and we tried you with various trials. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa. Allah made Musa successful and gave him deliverance. But why did he do this? From the reasons that Musa received this is from the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Musa himself, he said after he killed that individual, he said, Rabbi inni zalamtu nafsi faghfir li faghfara lahu innahu huwa al-ghafur rahim. When he killed that individual, that individual from the Aqbat, he turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said, Oh my Lord, verily I have wronged myself, so forgive me. Then he, Allah, forgave him. Verily he is of forgiving and merciful. So Musa turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sought forgiveness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him deliverance. فَنَجَّيْنَاكَ مِنَ الْغَمِّ وَفَتَنَّاكَ فُتُونَ. And we saved you and delivered you from your grief. Because he was a mustaghfir. He was an individual who sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَيَا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ دَعْنَا نَكُنْ مِنَ الْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ. Let us be from those who seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another example, and the best of example, is the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Khatim Nabiyyin, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he who taqaddama, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ghafara Allahu lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbihi wa ma ta'akhkhar. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the messenger, the prophet. Allah forgave that which he has done from before and after. But yet he was mustaghfir. He was an individual, Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that was mustaghfir, that sought forgiveness from Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. And this is mentioned in As-Sahihain, in Bukhari Muslim, and Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu. قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول والله إني لا أستغفر الله وأتوب إليه في اليوم أكثر من 70 مرة وفي الرواية في اليوم 100 مرة. He said صلى الله عليه وسلم in Bukhari Muslim that by Allah I seek forgiveness from Allah and repent to Him in one day more than 70 times. More than 70 times صلى الله عليه وسلم. And in another narration from Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Fil yawmi mi'at marra, in a day 100 times. And that's in Sahih Muslim. And the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, they witnessed this from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Kunna na'udu li rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fil majlis al-wahid yaqulu rabbi ighfirli wa tub alayya innaka anta tawwabu al-ghafur 100 marra. The Sahaba witnessed this. They witnessed this. And that is that they said in this hadith of on this athar of Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, said we used to count with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one sitting, that he would say, Oh my Lord, forgive me and accept my repentance. Verily you are the oft forgiven. He will say this 100 times. They will count that. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So we have to be barakallahu feekum from those who are mustaghfirin, those who seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions and he says, وَصَدْعَ الْقَلْبِ بِأَمْرَيْنِ. He said the rustiness of the heart is from two affairs. There are two affairs that cause the rustiness of the heart, or the reasons why a heart is rusty. And that is بِالْغَفْلَةِ وَالذَّنْبِ, with negligence and sins. This causes the heart, these two affairs causes the heart to become rusty. وَجَلَاءُهُ بِشَيْئَيْنِ بِالْإِسْتِغْفَارِ وَالذِّكْرِ. And the loftiness of the heart that becomes healthy, the heart that is healthy and has that loftiness is by two affairs. And that is al-istighfar wa dhikr. Seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remembering Him, making dhikr. So this no doubt is an immense ingredient of success as relates to trials and affliction. And in this statement of Ibn Qayyim, he mentions, says that shay'ain al-istighfar wa dhikr. Seeking forgiveness and making dhikr and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this moves us on smoothly to the fifth ingredient, and that is dhikrullah. The fifth ingredient of success in times of trials is being one that remembers Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا لِي وَلَا تَكْفُرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 152, he said, so remember me, I will remember you, and be grateful to me, and do not disobey me. So we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the people who are dhakirin. As Al-Rabi' rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرُكُمْ وَاشْكُرُونِي وَلَا تَكْفِرُوا أَيْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ ذَاكِرُ مَنْ ذَكَرَهُ وَزَائِدُ مَنْ شَكَرَهُ وَمُعَذِّبُ مَنْ كَفَرَهُ. What he said, Rahimullah, Rabi' Rahimullah, he said, regarding that verse, verily Allah remembers the one that remembers him in aiding them, supporting them, giving them deliverance. وَزَائِدُ مَنْ شَكَرَ, and he increases the one that is grateful, the one that is shakir, the one that is grateful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases them and punishes the one that is a disbeliever and ungrateful. So yeah, ibadallah, from this verse, it's important for us to understand that we have to be those who constantly remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remembering Allah in the morning, remembering Allah with the adhkar, the supplications and the dua. Remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we leave our house, when we enter our house, when we go to the bathroom, when we leave the bathroom, when we eat after we've eaten, when we enter the masjid, when we leave the masjid, when we're in a majlis, we remember Allah while we're in that majlis to say that which is beloved to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during salah, focused in our salah bitama'un and khushu', concentration and humility, and remember Him after our salah and our prayers. We become dhakirin. But also, my dear beloved brothers and sisters, we remember Allah in times of shidda, but we also remember Allah in times of raha. We remember Allah in times of difficulties, and we also remember Him in times of ease. Which is why Sa'id ibn Jubair, rahimullah ta'ala, he said regarding this verse, اذكروني في النعمة والرخاء أذكركم في الشدة والبلاء. Allah meaning that, remember me in the times of hardship, and remember me in the times of ease and blessings, I will remember you in your times of hardship and trials and tribulations and afflictions. So no doubt this is a fiqh, great fiqh from Sa'id ibn Jubair, which shows us, barakallahu feekum, that remembering Allah in all times indeed is from the ingredients of success in times of trials and tribulation. After this, barakallahu feekum, we mention a statement from Ibn Qayyim rahimullah, and that he said in his book, Al-Wabil al-Sayyib, he mentions the benefits and fruits of remembering Allah, of dhikr. He mentions 100 fa'idah. He mentions 100 benefits in remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm going to select two of these benefits. The first is the ninth benefit that he mentions, and that is that he said regarding dhikr, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَنَّهُ يُورِثُ الْمُحَبَّةِ الَّتِي هِيَ رُوحِ الْإِسْلَامِ وَقَطْبِ رُوحِ الدِّينِ وَمِدَارُ السَّعَادَةِ وَالنَّجَاهِ. He says, Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, that making dhikr and having dhikr and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inherits al-muhabba, loving Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And this is the soul of Islam. This is the pinnacle of Islam, that the individual loves Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And the essence of this deen, this religion, and this is where salvation and happiness revolves around. So the person who remembers Allah increases in the love of Allah. He increases in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this statement of Ibn Qayyim is muhim jiddan, that dhikr inherits the love of Allah and loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And loving Allah is the soul, the ruh of al-Islam and the pinnacle of this deen. And sa'ada, happiness and bliss and salvation revolves around this. And he mentions, rahimullahu ta'ala, in the 16th benefits, from the many benefits he mentions of remembering Allah, he says, أَنَّهُ يُورِثُ حَيَاةَ الْقَلْبِ. He said, rahimullah, that remembering Allah, a dhikr, it inherits life and makes there be life in the heart. It brings the heart to life. And Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, as the one who reads his books, knows that he refers a lot to his teacher, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. And in this point he did that. He said, حَدَرْتُ Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah مَرَّةً صَلَّ فَجْرِ. He said, I was with Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah one time when he prayed Fajr. ثُمَّ جَلَسَ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ جَلَسَ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهِ تَعَلَى إِلَىٰ قَرِيبٍ مِنْ انْتِصَافِ اللَّيْلِ النَّهَارِ. And that is that he said he sat with Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah after Fajr. And Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimullah, was remembering Allah, making dhikr. From Fajr, after Fajr, to the last, or to half of the day. To half of the day. ثُمَّ إِلْتَفَتْ إِلَيَّ. And then he said that Ibn Taymiyyah turned to him. وَقَالْ هَذِهِ غَدْوَتِي. He said, this is my nourishment, remembering Allah. وَلَوْ لَمْ أَتَغَدَّ الْغَدَىٰ سَقَطَتْ قُوَّتِي. He said, if I do not have my nourishment, my strength will go. This is how the ulama, they recognize the importance of a dhikr and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You remember Allah from after Fajr to the half of the day, to Saf al-Nahar. And he said, if I do not nourish myself, if I don't get my nourishment, I'll lose my strength. And that strength, no doubt, my dear beloved brothers and sisters, is in times of shiddah and rakha, is in times of hardship and ease, in times of tests and trials. The heart needs to have this quwwah, it needs to have this life. Barakallahu feekum. In order to be successful as it relates to the trials and tribulations